heading its production division and focusing mainly on agricultural engineering research. The background of Dr. Polycarpou is mechanical engineering, initially studying at the High Technological Institute in Cyprus and then specializing in energy and process engineering and agricultural engineering in Hanover University in Germany, obtaining MSc and PhD degrees. And he has also an MSc in Management and Public Administration from the Mediterranean Institute of Management. Some of the areas of Dr. Polycarpou's work and expertise are, I will name a few, environmental control issues of greenhouses, development of open and closed hydroponic systems, drying of agricultural products using alternative energy sources, biofuel production from biomass, and other applications of new technology in agriculture. Dr. Polycarpou has participated and participates as a coordinator or collaborator in various European research projects and RPF programs. Since 2017, he is also an adjunct associate professor here at the Cyprus Institute, and this is one of the examples of our increasing ties and collaboration with the Agricultural Research Institute. So, nothing else from me. I welcome Dr. Polycarpou to talk to us about challenges in modern horticulture and greenhouse technology.
Thank you very much for the kind introduction. It's nice to see you, everybody here. Thank you very much for coming and sharing with us some of your time. The subject is very big, as you know, greenhouse technology. So we will try in this little time that we have here available to present some as of the main things, let's say, in the subject, and make a general idea about what a greenhouse is and what the future trends in greenhouse technologies are. We are going to talk about the construction of the greenhouses, how we construct them, and what are the main justification points that we should look in order to select the proper greenhouse. The situation in Cyprus regarding the greenhouse technology, something about the climate control in greenhouses, the cultivation in the soil or in hydroponics carried out in greenhouses, innovative techniques that are applied in Cyprus, and energy saving measures, something about heat pumps in greenhouses and geothermal heating applied in Cyprus regarding the greenhouse heating and all this, and something about future research, and then the concluding remarks. I would like to start with a general question, a global question. And perhaps one or two of you say something about this. What are the greenhouses needed for? Can somebody so just...
Especially in Cyprus.
Yes.
To grow horticultural products under controllable conditions.
Very nice. That's very correct. But somebody else to try. There is something additional to that. Okay, let's proceed. The problem, not the problem. The answer, let's say, the global answer is to make money. Like any other business. So considering building a greenhouse and working in a greenhouse should always have in the background that it is a business and we should try to make money out of it, and it's not just a toy or something for researchers to play around and find something exciting and something new. So about the construction of greenhouses, it's okay, as Edward said, important because we can control the growth parameters of the plants that we would like to grow, like the temperature, the air humidity, the CO2, the light, and the water needed for irrigation. We need greenhouses in order to control all these important parameters. try to create an optimized microclimate for the plants, provide protection from weather conditions like wind, snow, rain, and all this, provide protection from pests, facilitate disease control, facilitate water management, and provide support for the plants, for instance, in trellis systems. And you can see here for, it's not a very good picture, but you can see the lines used for hanging the plants and supporting the plants so they can go upright and cultivate in a given surface in the greenhouse as a large number of plants as possible. This is what we call the trellis system. And the main technical requirements for a commercial greenhouse are to obtain high efficiency in production, low energy consumption, long-lasting materials in order to minimize the maintenance cost, which is an important cost factor, let's say, in every business. Low labor input by utilizing, for instance, automation, sustainable environment-friendly operation, and best of all, good management. This is what, let's say, mainly fails in Cyprus, because our farmers, which are usually old farmers, do not qualify, let's say, for as good managers in greenhouses. The right greenhouse type has to be selected according to the climatic conditions of the area that we are going to construct a greenhouse, taking into account the wind conditions, the rain, solar radiation, intensity and duration, let's say, during the day, the air temperature and humidity in the region, and of course, the kind of the crop. Is it a vegetable crop? Needed to be hung by trellis, as you have seen before, or are vegetables low that do not require hanging? Are they full of agricultural crops, like cut flowers, pot plants, and so on, aromatic plants, or generally the height of the crop? This should determine, let's say, the dimensions, the height, and the type of the greenhouse that we are going to build. The market situation is very important. High value crops make it possible for high investments on structures. The state of technology, what automation is shown, what processing is needed in order to apply this in our business. The climate control that we should apply in order to provide the best climate needed for the culture that we intend to cultivate. And the market price of the products, which determine also our profit later. The grower abilities, the education level of the growers, the willingness to learn and apply new technology, the ability to cooperate with the specialists are very important parameters for the greenhouse construction. The available materials locally are also very important. If we have to import everything, it's going to be an expensive construction. And the available labor, skilled labor and generally labor for the operation of the greenhouse should be available in the area. Also, the location and orientation criteria have to be selected, have to be, let's say, determined from the beginning so that we know that by having a knowledge, let's say, regarding the climatic conditions of the area, we can determine also the energy demand of the greenhouse, and later we shall see what accessories are needed for the climate control, heating, cooling, and all this. The movement of the sun is very important, which determines the orientation of the plant rows in the greenhouse. The availability of good quality of water for irrigation is very important, because we need water for irrigation, especially if it's going to be, let's say, a system, an advanced system, like a hydroponic one that we are going to see later. Availability of good soil quality is also an important factor if we are going to grow in the soil. The wind condition, the wind strength and direction, so that we know if we have to use wind breakers and take other measures to avoid the destruction of our greenhouse through winds. The availability of labor force again, the space available around the greenhouse for the utilities that we're going to need, storerooms, packing houses, parking stations, boiler rooms, and all of this should fit around the greenhouse. And also, having in mind that it may be necessary to have future expansion needs in case that we need to expand our business later on. The proximity to adequate consumer centers, our market, let's say, for the products, is very important. The disposal of waste products, it's a very trendy aspect. The artificial substrates, the plastic, the organic material, and all this needs to be recycled. And applying the rules of circular economy nowadays, this has to be also studied and included in our decision how we are going to construct a greenhouse. The construction characteristics are therefore very obvious after we have done the previous research, so we can decide about the wind, the length, the type of the greenhouse, the construction materials that we're going to need with steel, aluminium, wood structures, and all this, and the cladding material that we're going to use. In Europe, you know, and some parts of America, they use, for instance, glass as covering material, which is not good for our regions due to the high solar irradiation that we have. So people in our region, in Mediterranean, let's say generally, and Cyprus and Israel that have similar conditions like ours, they prefer the plastic, the low density polyethylene film, which presents very good properties, and it's also at low cost. 40 years ago, you can see the greenhouses as we used to use in Cyprus, made of wood. You can see the construction is made of wood and plastic cover. Nowadays, we have to take into consideration the very difficult situation that we see due to climatic conditions, that we have strong winds and we have heavy rain and all this. This, for instance, here that you see, used to be a greenhouse located in this area, which is cleaned up next to the pile of iron mass that the greenhouse became due to a storm. This was a battery design greenhouse, and this is how it ended up to be. So, in order to control the environment of the greenhouse, we need to use some utilities, some auxiliary systems, like heating system, which could be a hot air generator or hot water system. Ventilation systems, we can distinguish natural ventilation with roof openings and side wall openings, and for forced ventilation using fans in order to drive the air through the greenhouse and induce, let's say, the ventilation. In some cases, we need a cooling system. It could be direct water injection, creating fog in the greenhouse, or fan and pad system, which is most usually used in Cyprus. We're going to see later what the description of these systems. Sometimes we could use artificial CO2. Cyprus is not very used. We're going to explain later about that. And some screens, shading screens or energy screens, that they can be used for energy saving in the greenhouse. And also for monitoring the light reaching the plants for to facilitate their growth. Artificial lighting is sometimes used for some plants, usually floricultural plants. soil cultivation or artificial substrate is another decision that we should take. Should we cultivate in soil or should we use hydroponic systems? And again, the water management system is very important because, you know, in Cyprus and the whole Mediterranean, water is short. We don't have available lots of water, so we have to make a good management of water. You can see here, in case that we don't have very good water quality, we can use a desalination unit, a very small desalination unit. This is a one unit that we have at ARI in Zigi. It produces 1 cubic meter of fresh water per hour, so it's 24 cubic meters per day, let's say. And we can store it in a store to be used for irrigation of the greenhouses. So the total world greenhouse vegetable production area is over 460,000 hectares. The vegetable greenhouse production sector is highly labor intensive. There are attempts to automate the processes, but because of the cost, unfortunately, there is not much progress in the Mediterranean region. It could be in Holland or in other parts of the world. An application of automation, let's say, more automatic systems, but in Cyprus is still low. And the high-tech greenhouses are located primarily in Northern Europe and comprise only 10% of the total greenhouse market. So you see there is a lot to be done in direction automation. Since 1974, and the higher standard of living resulted after the invasion, and the prosperity created also through the presence of tourism and all the new situation that was created in Cyprus after the invasion, it resulted in the creation of a market with higher purchasing power, ready to absorb more expensive products. And this also demanded round the year production of various products. And a problem resulted in the last years, last 8 years, I could say, because of the economic crisis, that made the growth of greenhouse cultivation rapidly go down. And also the globalization and the competition with imported products, the export possibilities that could be applied, and are also, we know the problems that because we don't have a road connection to Europe or good cheap connection, the export possibility, let's say, are very limited. But this was also a factor that promoted, let's say, greenhouse cultivation in the last years. And this had to do also with the improved mobility of the people in Cyprus, because we know that our farmers visit other establishments abroad, and they also visit horticultural exhibitions abroad, so they get informed and they know the technologies that are there, and they try to apply them to their greenhouses. In Cyprus, we have now around 300 hectares of plastic film high tunnels greenhouses, and about the same amount of multi-span greenhouses. And you know that the total contribution on the national gross product of agriculture is limited down to 3%, which is, of course, low, but very important for the security, for the food security, and say in Cyprus. So this should not be underestimated. This is the territorial distribution of greenhouses. You can see that the greenhouses are mainly located in the coastal areas of Cyprus. And because of course of the climatic conditions, they are more favorable there. And also the tourists are there, which as we have seen before, the market is close to the production. So the trends now in Cyprus are for larger greenhouses with increased mechanization or automation to reduce labor. And new covering materials are needed in order to reduce the fastening cost of the covering of the greenhouse and to improve the light transmission properties of the covering. The use of new technology is a trend now with artificial substrates and hydroponics, automatic fertilizer mixing and dosing units, which are mainly coupled with hydroponics, and clever automation in climate control so as to control the temperature. And the main problem, as we are going to see also later in Cyprus, is the relative humidity in the greenhouses, which causes an outbreak, let's say, of fungal diseases in the greenhouses that makes a lot of destruction. And of course, water treatment, as you have seen before, is needed because we don't have very good water quality for irrigation. And another trend, very good for, let's say, for the greenhouse cultivation in Cyprus, is that young people are attracted in this sector, and this is the hope, let's say, of the young generation, that the young generation is entering the business and they are going to make it things better because they are more educated and they are more open-minded. Here you can see some low tunnels. You can see the plants covered in low tunnels. This is for protection of in winter, let's say, and speed up the growth so that the production is not delayed by low temperature. Here you see the high tunnels where people can walk in. The cultivation is done in the soil in this case. And you can see the shape of the tunnels. That's why they are called tunnels, because they are tunnels. So to distinguish them from multi-farm peeing greenhouses, which are actually, you can see that they are tunnels but attached to each other, and they make a bigger greenhouse. The plastic film has to have fulfill some properties in order to be used. It's easy for installation. It has high light transmittance in the photosynthetic active radiation, PAR radiation. And the thermal properties are very good, regarding heat transfer. Long-lasting RD3 properties are needed so as to prevent drops from the condensation in the greenhouse to fall on the plants and make outbreak, help to the outbreak of diseases. Anti-dust properties, we know that they are, especially the last time, we have problems with dust in Cyprus, and polyethylene is charged with static electricity, and dust comes and sticks on the polyethylene, making problems. It prevents, let's say, the light to enter the greenhouse. So we need plastic films that are anti-static. They should have UV stabilization so that they have a high lifetime. They should be sulfur resistant because a lot of chemicals are used nowadays to fight fungal diseases that contain sulfur, and sulfur destroys polyethylene. So they should be resistant to this chemical element. some special photomorphological properties could be given by using certain types of films. We have made some experiments some years ago at ARI in a European project. You know that blue spectrum in the radiation promotes site growing of the plants, and red light promotes high growing of the plants. So a combination of these, let's say, could help in forming the cultivation of the plants, especially if the plants are going to be, let's say, floricultural plants, or even tomatoes, because with blue light, side shoots are coming, and you need to cut them every time, so if we need high manpower. Red light promotes only the top, let's say, movement of the upright movement of the plant, so you need less working force in order to trim the plants. Some films are produced nowadays with anti-insect properties, and again, they should be recyclable for environmental protection. There is a project now by Research Promotion Foundation that we are working on that should, let's say, create a recycling system for the greenhouse plastic. The visible light, we know that is between 390 and 780 nanometers. And the plants are operating in about the same range, between 400 and 700 nanometers, which is the so-called photosynthetically active radiation, PAR. And this is the radiation that the plants need in order to photosynthesize, to get CO2 and water, and produce, let's say, sugars and grow the whole plants. So the ideal plastic, let's say, for greenhouse should operate in this range. You see here the solar radiation during a day. You can see it can go up to more than 1,000 watts per square meter, the solar radiation. So a lot of heat is passed into the greenhouse, and a large quantity of heat is evolved, let's say. So we have to remove all this heat and climatize the greenhouse. And this is, of course, the greenhouse effect. We have the sun radiating in the greenhouse in a shortwave radiation, which is warming up the plants and all the things in the greenhouse, which re-radiate them in low wave radiation that should go outside, and so as to keep the temperature in the greenhouse constant. But because of the covering, this low wave radiation doesn't go out very easily, so the temperature rises in the greenhouse, and we have the so-called greenhouse effect. So ideally, you see here the black line is the spectral beam radiation of the solar light. You can see that the solar light has a maximum radiation between 0.4 and 0.8, let's say 0.7. Actually, micrometers, or 480 to 700 nanometers. And this is the PAR radiation, actually. So an ideal peak cover should be to allow this radiation, only the red radiation, to come in the greenhouse, and the rest should be cut off. This rest radiation is the radiation that causes the high temperature involvement in the greenhouse, and also problems created because of this in summer months, and we need to ventilate or we need to cool down the greenhouse. So, how do we do this climate control in the greenhouses? You can see that high humidity levels in the greenhouse can cause destruction of our plants, either mildew or downy mildew. So we need to control the environment. In the period of 1980 to 1986, we had a cooperation at ARI with GTZ, the German agency for cooperation, German agency for technical cooperation, and we studied the possibility of heating the greenhouses utilizing the solar energy. You can see here the collectors that we have manufactured at that time. The aim was to manufacture low-cost collectors so that the greenhouses could be heated with as low cost as possible. You can see here the passive system that was developed at that time. It's just polyethylene sleeves. You can see the sleeves here, filled with water. And because of the heat coming up in the greenhouse, let's say during the day, this water heats up and in the night can provide some heating in the greenhouse and mainly could help, let's say, in frost protection in the greenhouse. Cultivation could be saved from frost in this by having this system. You can see here a close view of the polythene sleeve. So in commercial greenhouses, heating is done either by conventional ways, with a boiler, let's say, operating using either diesel oil or LPG, and then heating the greenhouse through a heat exchanger. You can see these black lines here under the benches. They are polyethylene pipes, corrugated, having a so large surface, utilized as heat exchangers in the greenhouse, and because they are cheap. Because other systems that we use in houses and hotels and all this would be very expensive for a greenhouse. So we utilize the heat exchange through these polyethylene pipes. You could need, let's say, in a greenhouse 4 or 5 kilometers of this. So you imagine what the cost would be if these pipes were made of copper or aluminium or iron. And an alternative to that is the use of renewable energies for heating, like solar energy, biomass, or geothermal energy. You can see in this case the geothermal heat pumps, we're going to see also later, that are used to heat the greenhouses. You can see also here the closer view, the pipes used under the benches in this hydroponic cultivation, and are used as heat exchangers for delivering the heat from the boiler to the greenhouse. Here is a small prototype that we have used at the ARI some years ago for solar heating. Again, you heat the water through solar water panels, you store the heat in an intermediate tank, and then in the night you use the heat, you circulate it in the greenhouse using a pump through the same heat exchangers that we have seen, the pipe heat exchangers, in order to heat the greenhouse. Another way is to heat the greenhouse not using water but air. You can see here the air heater. You can see the sleeves, the air sleeves. When the air heater operates, it blows air through these sleeves, which comes out from the side and heats up the greenhouse. Of course, the setting temperature in the greenhouse is very important because you can see the higher the temperature that we set our system to operate, the higher also the consumption of energy generally. here is heating oil, diesel oil, you know, but any type of energy will be higher, the higher the temperature we choose a set temperature in the greenhouse. So this needs to be very much carefully selected in order to pass together with our plants and not be very excessive, because this will be cost, extra cost, because of the oil consumption. And then, besides heating, we have also cooling in summer. The most appropriate to be used system in Cyprus and in the Mediterranean also is the fan and pump cooling system. This is, you can see this black. The area here is a paver, actually, with holes, which I'll see later. And the air comes through these holes in this paver. This paver is wetted continuously through water coming through the gutter. You see the gutter above and the gutter below. Water drizzles down, is collected below, comes to a tank. Through a pump, it goes up again and continuously wet test this surface, and the air passing through is being cooled down by the evaporative cooling effect. Here you can see the actual picture of it. You can see the cooling part here, the gutter above, the gutter below. And this is the one side of the greenhouse. The other side of the greenhouse are the fans, which are used to extract the air through the greenhouse and force it to come through the paver that we have seen before and get cooled by the water that drizzles down the pad. Here you can see a close view of this cooling pad. You can see the new cooling pad here, how it looks, and you can see it after some years, 2 or 3 years, not much, because the quality of our water is very bad, and the salt accumulation is carried out in this surface, and in a very short time, these holes, these alleys that are in the paver are closed, and the system does not operate anymore. Here you can see actually one of the holes that goes through the so you can see here a picture of it, how the salts accumulate on the paver. And then, of course, we go to the subject of ventilation. It could be ventilation by natural means. You can see here. You can see here the opening in the greenhouse. From the inside now, you can see the opening of the roof window. The half side of the greenhouse is going up and down, creating an opening, and the air passes through. We have a better picture here. Here you can see the side window. The air comes through the side window. There is also a net, an insect net, which prevents insects from going into the greenhouse. And the air comes in and goes through the roof opening. You can see here. So here is a side window. The air comes in and goes out. Here is from the outside of the greenhouse. You can see how the roof opening it opens so as to allow the air, the warm air, to come through. So there is a natural ventilation, there's a natural circulation, let's say, of the air in the greenhouse, and is kept, the temperature is kept low. You can see here this diagram that according to the air changes, that let's say 50, it means that in an hour, we exchange the air of the greenhouse 50 times by a fan. Let's say. So as the air changes per hour increase, the temperature difference in the greenhouse is becoming less because more heat is extracted. And this is depending also on how many plants or how big the plants are in the greenhouse. You can see that if the plants are very big or the number is big, then the temperature difference is low. And if there are no plants in the greenhouse, the temperature difference is high. If, for instance, outside we have 40 air changes, if outside the temperature is 20, then it's going to be 26 in the greenhouse, in an empty greenhouse. In a planted greenhouse, it should be 22, for instance, 23. And again, the comparison here is between the ventilation and the cooling pans. You can see that, let's say, for 35 degrees centigrade, the outside temperature, in the greenhouse with a cooling system, we have about 32. Without cooling system, we have about 38. So you see the effect of the cooling system using cooling pads, how big it is. And of course, in the coastal areas where the humidity is high, this effect is low because there is no room for extra water to enter the already humid air. Here is an example of measured values that we had in our experiments in Acadia some time ago. The green line or yellow line is the outside temperature, and you can see the blue line with the cooling pack, how the temperature is kept around 35, let's say, or even less, according to the solar irradiation or so. And the pink line is the automatic natural ventilation system. You can see that the temperature goes up to 40 degrees, having only natural ventilation, but it, at the same time, it could drop down to 32 if we use a cooling system. So knowing the data of the area, we can construct the so-called climate charts. This is for Paphos. And if we know the temperature, the air temperature, and the solar irradiation, we can create for every month. You can see these lines. The red line, for instance, is based on minimum air temperature. And the blue line is based on maximum air temperature. So we know, for instance, that in December, we have 500 watts per square meter solar irradiation by 13 degrees centigrade. So by this, we can set the limits we need for our greenhouse. The orange line is the limit, let's say, for humidity, 60%. The lila line is the cooling threshold. We would like to keep the temperature, let's say, below 25 degrees. The green line is the heating threshold. We would like to keep our temperature in the greenhouse above 13 degrees. So the working range of the greenhouse, let's say, is in this range. And we know that the best system is below also the 60%. So we know that for, let's say, August, we can apply in this area the funnel path system, but not in these summer months where we need it actually, because at this point we have high relative humidity of air and the efficiency of the system would be low. It's very good this way, this system, this demonstration, in order to show the limits of these technologies that we apply. And you can see here, for instance, that if you are using an automatic system, automated system, you can see the outside temperature, how it goes. You can see the power breakdown was right in the morning. So you can see that the windows remained closed at this time in the morning because there was no electric power to open them. And the temperature rise up to more than 65 degrees. And of course, the cultivation in these temperatures is destroyed. So you have to take measures in automatic systems and have a backup generator, for instance, in order to avoid this incident from happening. And you can see that when the electricity came, immediately the temperature went down, but it was too late because of these hours, 3, 4, 5 hours, the temperature was very high and the culture was destroyed. So, who are we going to grow? In soil or in hydroponics? In soil, we need cultivation of the soil. We need weed removal. We need to disinfect the soil. Up to some years ago, we could fumigate with methyl bromide and kill every pathogen in the soil, and that was okay. But this methyl bromide was banned because it's very dangerous for human beings. So the only way that remained was to solarize the soil. That means we cover the whole greenhouse area with polyethylene cover. We irrigate inside so as to create humidity. And from the solar radiation in the summer, the steam that was created below the polyethylene layer killed the pathogens. Not so efficiently as methyl bromide, but it is something. And then in soil cultivation, we have also water loss, because about 40% of the water that we irrigate escapes in an area that the roots of the system cannot reach. Now, in the hydroponic system, of course, we allow cultivation of degraded soils. We don't care about the quality of the soil because we cultivate on artificial substrates. And we could save water up to 30% by applying the hydroponic system because the water that we use there is metered according to the needs of the plants. You can see here a picture of an in-soil cultivation. You can see the soil, you can see the irrigation lines, you can see the plants. And again, in a similar greenhouse, you can see the cultivation on artificial substrates. You can see the benches where the substrate are located. And then we have to decide about the kind of hydroponic system that we are going to use. Is it going to be an open hydroponic system or a closed one? Usually in Cyprus, and of course in the Mediterranean region, we apply the open hydroponic system. That means we have the fertilizer mixer, which takes the nutrients and the acid needed for the pH control of the water. We make the recipe needed for the plants. We give it to the plants. The leachate, the water that runs back, is collected in a tank, in a reservoir, and then is used for irrigation of other crops because it cannot be used again. That's why it's called open hydroponic system. In this way, we lose a lot of water that contains nutrients, which are very expensive and valuable. That's why the closed hydroponic system was evolved, let's say, and some farmers use it nowadays. The system is the same, but the leachate is no more rejected from the system, but is being cleaned by using UV radiation. So it is, let's say, being free from pathogens that could be in the water and can be used again. So we have a closed loop, and the fresh water needed is just minimal in order to let's say, supplying the water taken by the plants and the water evaporated. So this is a very good system, can save a lot of water, but of course it has this risk of pathogens, and because this UV cannot be very effective sometimes. Here you can see the substrates with channels on the ground, directly on the ground. You can see the channel here where the water is running back. You can see here the system on benches where the irrigation water, you can see the irrigation water, irrigation line which supplies water, and then you can see the yellow lines here which get the water which is leaching from the substrate and is collected to be reused again. And here are the automatic fertilizer mixers. You can see here the unit. The stock solutions for the fertilizers. Here the fertilizers and the acid are stored in a form that they are 100 times more dense than needed for the irrigation. And then this amount is taken by the mixer, is diluted with water, and the recipe necessary for the plants is prepared so that the irrigation water contains the nutrients really needed for the plants at the pH needed for the good operation of the plants. Here is another type of mixer, and you can see also the tanks next to it. Here is a type of UV radiation used for disinfection of the water that we have talked before, of the closed system. The water comes in the system, it's being, it passes through the UV lamp, and the pathogens are killed. Now, regarding pollination. Regarding the pollination, you can see here that in this example of the tomato, you can see the flowers here. The pollen has to reach the hibernus and produce tomatoes. This is done by the bubble bees. They are special bees that come in on the flowers and make pollination possible. Some time ago, we used the vibrators. You can see the tip here, using batteries, it vibrates, and you touch it on the flowers and can pollinate the flower. Here you can see the bubble bee operating on the flower. And nowadays, we are trying to find a robotic system, let's say, not we especially, but in the different parts of the world. You can use robots in order to make this pollination possible. The spraying in the system in the greenhouse is facilitated through using ultra low volume sprayers. The chemicals are placed in this tank that you can see here, let's say, here, and in a form of fog is sprayed through the greenhouse, and the pathogens are, the diseases, let's say, are monitored. Some innovative techniques that we use in Cyprus is the supply of CO2 in the greenhouse. In some tanks, you know that the natural ppm content, CO2 content, is around 308 ppm. If we raise this to 1,000, then we multiply the photosynthesis in the plants, we speed up the photosynthesis, and we can produce more products. You can see here the device that burns gas and produces CO2 for the greenhouse. You can see here the diagram how it is done. You can see the CO2 here in the morning hours, and then during in the day hours, and then during the night, and again during the morning. In the night, the CO2 is high because the plants produce CO2. So in the morning, as soon as the sun comes, photosynthesis starts, and you see the CO2 dropping down. If they put, if there is a good ventilation, then the content, let's say here at the lower point, fluctuates around the outside air CO2 content. And by adding artificial CO2, we could do it in these morning hours or afternoon hours, after the windows are closed. You can supply CO2 until the sunset, and then the plants produce their own CO2 and they don't need to apply it anymore. Some energy saving measures, some 30 years ago, we have done experiments at ARI with double roof cover, which could save up to 30% of the energy in the greenhouse. But because of the expensive cost of the double roof, this technology was not advanced. You can see nowadays that eternal shading is used, and the energy screens, in order to, you can see the screens here, which are used to monitor the light and the energy escaping from the greenhouse. You can have outside external shading applied, let's say, so abroad. In Cyprus, you cannot apply it because we have tried it some time ago in ARI, but it was very expensive, and due to the high winds, the system could not withstand the cold pressure. So the heat pumps could be used for heating. In our aquifer, in our subsoil, we don't have the geothermal, let's say, fields, but we can utilize the heat stored in shallow soil, the shallow geothermal energy, in order to heat the greenhouse. Here you can see different types of heat pumps, the air-to-air, that means we get from the air outside the heat in order to heat the greenhouse inside, or air-to-water, from the air outside we heat water and then use the water for our processes, or water-to-water, we get the heat from water outside or from geothermal, and we use it again to heat water inside. The geothermal field is after some meters, after 20 to 30 meters, is constant, the temperature in the soil. So if we utilize this stored heat in this area, we could operate a geothermal heat pump and heat the greenhouses. Here you can see the heat pumps that we use at ARI. You can see the wells with the heat exchangers coming out. You can see the header of the heat exchangers and the heat pumps, and the heat is distributed from the heat pumps again in the greenhouse through the heat exchangers that we have talked before, the polyethylene pipes. Here is the whole system. You can see the header. These pipes go directly in the wells of the geothermal. Here is the heating pump, the heat pump, the geothermal. And here is an intermediate tank which contains the warm water that is used to heat the greenhouse. Generally, the whole systems in the greenhouse can utilize, also need an electricity of about 45 kilowatt hours per day for a decade. You can see here different combinations of technology used. Heating and free ventilation is a blue. Heating, free ventilation, and cooling, forced ventilation, and cooling is the red line, which is most high in summer because of the cooling system. And heating and natural ventilation is the green line. Of course, you see in the summer it's very low because the windows, automatic windows, don't need much of energy to operate. Future research is needed in order to combine solar collection, solar energy with heat pumps, in order to apply, let's say, a cheap or more efficient heating system for greenhouses. Some time ago, we also used aeroponic cultivations at ARI. Here you can see some pictures dated from the year 2000. You can see the inside of the aeroponic pyramid structure. we are spraying sprayers, let's say, spray nozzles that spray from the inside the roots. You can see the plants placed outside. Their root system was sprayed from the inside by the nutrient solution. And of course, this system was very expensive. That's why the hydroponic system advanced more than this one. This is coming again back in most, in many research centers, but I think it doesn't have very good possibilities because of the mainly of the cost. Here we have to use to, 2 years ago at ARI also a combination of hydroponic and aquaponic cultivation. You can see here the the flowers. You can see the root system in these channels. These channels were flooded with a nutrient solution for some time, and then the nutrient solution was lowered, and the roots were remained in air for some time. It works very, very good, but again, it's in the research stage. Another emerging technology is the aquaponic. This is very interesting in many research centers in Europe and other parts of the world. Here, the main thing is to combine the cultivation of plants with the fish raising. You cultivate plants, you get the solution to the plants, to the fish. The fish produce their waste, which is transformed in special filters that have microbes and worms into nutrients to the plants, and again, it completes the cycle. It's a very interesting thing, and this is something perhaps that we should spend some time in researching, I think, this technology. You can see here, for instance, the plants, and you can see the fish below, and the whole thing is harmonically operating so that the nutrients needed by the plants are produced by the fish, so as to have a very environmentally friendly system. Here is the challenge of a closed cell water at a low energy greenhouse that is emerging again. You can use seawater in order to monitor the humidity content in the greenhouse through evaporative surfaces, which are rinsed not with water but with liquid desiccant that can take off humidity and control the humidity in the greenhouse. And also in the regeneration unit, you can produce water, fresh water, for irrigation. So the system is self-sustained regarding energy and water needs. We have tried that at ARI. You can see here how the humidity goes. During the night, it's very high. It reaches 100%, so it rains into the in the greenhouse. And that was the main problem that we had some years ago at ARI, where we tested this system. We used to use solar collectors, where the hot air was introduced into a rock bed and stored there, the heat. And then in the night, the heat was circulated through fans in the greenhouse. And the main problem at that time, and it remains the same problem nowadays, is the high humidity that you create in the greenhouse. But at that time, we didn't have technology to help us, because controlling humidity at that time was impossible. Nowadays, we have new technologies. We have already some products. This is one device from Israel, where air enters the unit. It gets dehydrated, the air. You collect the water, you utilize it for irrigation, and you supply then dry air to the greenhouse. So the future trend is towards closed intelligent greenhouse that will enable, of course, hydroponic or soil cultivation, temperature control, humidity control, which is the most difficult part of the whole thing, good ventilation control, energy shading screens, artificial CO2 supply is supplied there because the greenhouse is closed, so you can supply CO2 without losing it to the atmosphere. And again, growers have to be trained to be good managers in order to operate such a very intelligent and automatic system, so as to produce higher quality, longer shelf life of the products, higher production yields, less pesticides, less water needs for irrigation, less fossil energy use, so low carbon footprint of the whole process, higher profits to the growers, because at the beginning we said that this is a business and we should maximize our profit, better working environment for the growers, which is also a motivation for young people to occupy themselves, to enter this business, because we have computers, we have monitoring systems, so this is a very good, attractive tool for young people. And you can sleep very easily having a new technology in your greenhouse because you have applied a fully automatic system, so no problem. Thank you very much.
Did you ever examine the atmosphere inside after the spraying and how much the workers are exposed to these pesticides? Because you are in a closed system.
Is that
my first question? And the second question is, using plastics, it's well known, and there are some studies now, that some compounds that are plasticizers, phthalates, they are leached because of the heating and the sunlight. And in China, for example, some greenhouses, they have found even 35 ppm in soils and plants of these compounds that we know that were exposed to food. So,
The compounds released depend also on the quality of the plastic that you use for the production of the film. So the film that we use in Europe or in our region is produced out of clean material, which doesn't have these things, pesticides or fumigants that are coming out of the polyethylene cover. China had this problem in the past, but now it's limiting it because it restricted the introduction, the import of polyethylene from countries that contain chemicals. Now they have waked up and they don't want this material. So they use also clean material. So I think that now they in China also their production is cleaner. And also the plastic that we use in Cyprus or in Europe is clean from this material. It's clean material. And the first question was?
It was the exposure of the people working.
Yes.
There after, because we have seen in the past that the dermal exposure is pretty high for people working after spraying in our greenhouse.
This is very important and is monitored from the automatic system because you cannot open the door to enter the greenhouse while it is spraying, for instance. Or 10 hours after it has been sprayed. So you need enough time for the for this fog to settle down, then there is a process of good ventilation of the greenhouse, and then people are allowed to enter. So this is controlled automatically through the system that you should have, let's say, in operating such ULV technology. It's a very important factor for the
Yeah. Have you studied the possibility of using geothermal heat for cooling also as below 30 meters underground? The temperature is constant. It's definitely less than 40 or 45, which we have during the summer in Cyprus. Have you studied for this possibility of using this cooling also?
We have studied it in our adapt to change project that we have in Zili. And it seems to be very expensive because, you know, the operation of the heat pump at these low temperatures is more cost, let's say, more costly. So we utilize that in sometimes in order to cool the air or such an amount of air so as to get water from it and have some quantity of water for irrigation to cool down the whole air mass, which is large. And you know that the energy coming in the greenhouse is very large in summer. So in order to cool all this load, cooling load, let's say, you need large heat pumps, which are very costly, unfortunately. But there are some other methods. We are cooperating with the Cyprus Institute in order to solve all of this problem. We have some ideas which are in the research, let's say, stage up to now. And we can try, make some experiments, so in some times we can have some safe results, let's say, not to announce. I hope next time the project passes through, because now it was not. And
you give so much emphasis on saving in heat cost.
Yes.
You don't process it much on saving.
Because this is the main problem, let's say, in Cyprus. The purpose, let's say, of the whole thing, as we have seen, is the year-round utilization of the greenhouse. So to have a greenhouse that we utilize it all the 12 months per year, let's say. So in order to do that, you need to remove all this high intensity of heating load that there is in summer because of the solar radiation. And for this, you cannot do it, unfortunately, with the simple technology that we have. We have to utilize clever technologies that need a little bit more research. But we are on it.
Thank you.